Major Hurricane Erin is growing in size. Everybody, matter of fact, is going to get a lot bigger than it has already. And the wind field is really going to expand. It's threatening the Bahamas with chances for hurricane force wind gusts. Also, the east coast of the U.S. This is getting closer and closer towards that western side of the cone, just like we said days ago. Matter of fact, the ensembles is showing this is going to shift even further towards the west, according to the European. Now, another thing that's about to happen for Erin is in a very moist pocket. Wind shear is going down. There is going to be some dry air it might have to fight as it takes that northward push, but I'm showing it could combat that dust and it could fight that dry air. But at the same time, Major Hurricane Erin is about to rapid intensify once again, even giving it a good run for another Cat 5. Now, that's very important because the higher the strength this hurricane gets, a lot stronger is going to be when it goes by the East Coast than forecasted. Even National Hurricane Center says that the wind probabilities are probably lower than they should be for the East Coast. So I'm sure the latest information in this video, what you can expect from Major Hurricane Erin and the next wave coming right behind it. Now, if you take a look at the atmosphere that Hurricane Erin is in, you can see the big moist pocket. So you have the dry air. This is at the higher altitudes at 500 millibar level. And you can see all the outflow that is coming out of Erin combating all that dust. Just a great moist pocket that it is in. It is ready to intensify. Right now, it's still going through an eyewall replacement, and that is very important. The sooner this does an eyewall replacement, the sooner this will get up the road and be potentially a Cat 5 once again. Now, Hurricane Erin will get a lot bigger, and it's already gotten bigger, everyone. This is expected to get triple, if not four times its size by the time it goes up that East Coast, where waves could be anywhere from a maximum of 100 towards 50 feet way out into the ocean, but this will cause a lot of problems. Now, the latest information shows that the tropical storm force winds is reaching 205 miles outside of the center, and the hurricane force winds did grow from 25 miles to 45 miles outside of the center, and is going to grow even more. It's going to get a lot bigger. So look at this. This is the latest track that they are going by, and this is on the eastern side from what I can see. I think it's going to be a lot tighter, more towards that western side still, everybody. So picture this. You see all these big wind fields right here. Picture this further towards the west. So showing you could see tropical storm force winds anywhere from South Carolina towards the coast of Virginia. Also, it is the fifth hurricane to form before August 17th. It is the first Cat 5 in the Atlantic since Hurricane Dean in 2007, if you can remember that one. Plus, the second lowest pressure, 20 degrees north this early, of 915 millibars, behind Hurricane Allen 1980, 911 millibars. Latest advisory as of 5 p.m. is still showing that west-northwest track. Just like I told you, it's not going north-northwest. It's going west-northwest, which means it on the left side of the ensembles, which shows true, and it's on the left side of the cone. Right now, maximum sustained winds are already 125 miles per hour, and it's about to intensify for the next 24 hours. And you've seen what it did the last 24 hours. Not to mention, it's been moving west for the last 24 hours. Now, Hurricane Erin's eye diameter is increasing from 5 to 10 nautical miles to around 40 nautical miles. And if the replacement cycle completes, there should be a concentration of eye wall by tonight, where it will start going through its intensification episode, everybody. Also, Erin should remain in conducive environmental conditions and remain a dangerous major hurricane through the middle of this week. There's some dry air that can entrain in there, but I'm showing that it's going to fight that. And the longer it can fight that, the more it's going to be on that high-end level. Now, this is very important for North Carolina and the East Coast going towards the Northeast, because it's like y'all getting some of the impacts as well. You need to listen to this. Erin has been growing in size, and that trend is likely to continue over the next few days. The expanding wind field will result in rough ocean conditions over much of the western Atlantic. It should be noted that the 34 and 50 knot wind speed probabilities beyond 36 hours in the next text and graphical products are likely underestimating the risk of those winds occurring. So the tropical storm force winds are stronger. They're showing later on down the road when it gets closer towards y'all or underestimating the impacts. It is going to be much bigger. Still showing the same information as this morning. Plus, interest along the outer banks of North Carolina and Bermuda should monitor the progress of Erin, as there is a risk of strong winds associated with the outer rain bands during the middle part of this week. And And I'm showing those rain bands could reach all the way back towards South Carolina. This is going to be a big, broad system. And I'm showing as it goes northward, it gets pulled northward. So everything is going to be northward loaded. It's going to be some big banding going on. Plus, you have it going all the way up to 145 miles per hour. Last time we seen that, it went to 160, everybody. Not to mention, Erin is going through warmer waters than it did before. Even some strong deep ocean heat. This is going to be a powerful Cat 5 again, I do believe. So just to give you an example, if Hurricane Erin was way out here, about 150, 200 miles away from shore, right now with the wind field it has, which it will grow, 50 miles inland of impacts would be in this red. If it got a little bit bigger or wobbled further to the west, 100 miles, it would go even deeper. And if it got even closer towards the coast, right along the edge, 200 miles would be a big wind field. You also have to take this into effect. Erin went through this temperature of water. You can see it right there. It did intensify as soon as it got out of those cooler waters. Matter of fact, it started strengthening into cooler waters, which is very odd. But look what it's going through now. It's going through the warmest waters yet, all the way up to the coast of North Carolina, everybody. It's going through way warmer waters than it did before. And right now, it's sitting right about here. And it has all this deep ocean heat to still tap into as well. Here's another factor you can see right here with the three-day cone probability with the ensembles and making that curve. Look what Euro has to say about that. A big shift to the west, and it even could start wobbling. Now, normally you get rid of the far western and the far eastern ensemble. Usually those are the outliers because the group is what you follow. But look at the westward turn. Look at all these right here turning on the west side of that cone, making it even closer towards the coast. It's pivoting like this. It's pivoting towards North Carolina, then turning out. So North Carolina really has the biggest chance for impacts. Now, if you take a look, even one shows there's a chance for it to become a Cat 5. But regardless if it's a high-end Cat 4 or even a low-end Cat 5, all these show it will start going on that intensification period. And one thing you want to look at, is when it gets around Wednesday to Thursday, this is when it's going to be going by the East Coast. So when you look at Wednesday to Thursday, you see these going back on a positive note. You see these going back up from a weakening. You see that? They're going up from a weakening. So it's going to combat that dry air, and it's going to stay strong. This is going to be a high end. I don't think it's going to be a Cat 2. And we take a look with your relative humidity. You can see this with the Euro. So as you have all this big moist pocket that is dealing with, showing as it starts headed to north, it gets big, it gets broad, starts headed to north, then it starts getting some possible dry air getting pulled right into this center to where it has to fight it off. So that's what the Earl sees. You see how it fights it off, but it still keeps its initial push. And you have this big banding that's fighting any kind of dry air trying to get in past that. So it's trying to push that out, but showing in this one that the dry air will get towards the center, and that center eye will start getting a little bigger instead of being towards a tight pinhole. I'm showing it's going to hold very strong all the way to the last minute and get very close. Showing that it will get a tight center once again, a tight small eye. And as it heads towards the north, you can see that dry air that gets inside of it starts wobbling and widening out that eye. And it starts weakening down a little bit according to the latest run with the Euro. But when you look at the hurricane analysis forecast system A, but showing it has a great chance to intensify. Look at this. It brings it all the way up to 157 winds, everybody. This right here would be right at the 160 again, and still showing that it gets that dry air, but then it fights that dry air as it heads to the north, showing it close to the west coast. And you can see how it expands. You see how it expands once it goes past North Carolina, it expands towards the northeast. So look at a simulated infrared. It's messed up. Now it starts getting its eye together, and it gets a very small pinhole. You see that? It gets a very small pinhole and intensifies in 12 hours, potentially for a few hours. I think that has a great chance to run back at 150 or stronger, definitely stronger than 145. Then as it heads towards the north, it gets really big and broad, huge. Look at the banding that this comes into. So you can see the size of it now. It's already about double the size. This is going to get triple, if not quadruple, the size. And now you have the banding going all the way towards the Southern Caribbean. It's reaching so far. And look how big it grows as it goes from Tuesday and Northern. Now you're getting banding that's potentially whipping across the East Coast once you go by 10 a.m. on Wednesday. And look how that banding stretches to portions of South Carolina, a little bit of Virginia, as that passes by for Wednesday afternoon. Bringing strong bandings. This could bring tropical storm force winds, maybe even hurricane force wind gusts. And if it gets a little closer, it could be stronger, everybody. And look how it goes towards Delaware and towards the northeast when it curves towards the north, potentially bringing something towards y'all as well. And the icon keeps shifting it a little bit to the west. So you can see this here. Here's the 12Z run. This is in 72 hours in 3 days when it starts making that northward push. The new run just come in. It shifted again a little bit more towards the west. And that little shift to the west is going to make all the difference on the impacts. Showing with the icon, it's going to get very close. That wind field is going to spread from the Delmarva towards the portions of South Carolina. And right along the coast, showing very strong winds coming down with that. And if that pushes a little bit further towards the west, you're going to be seeing those browns come on shore of 50 and 60 miles per hour sustained winds. And just ripping right up that beach towards the northeast, filling in that northeastern pocket all along the coast with the waves coming with it as well. Showing that once we go through 1 a.m. on Wednesday, it's going to start feeling that tug from those winds going from the west to the east, and it's going to start pulling on Erin and start pulling Erin to that east northeast and then scooting it out. So it is going to be all the way towards early Wednesday morning before it starts feeling that tug. Until then, it don't have it. You see that? It's not wrapped around. It's not even touching it. Still showing you wave height could reach 50 way out here into the Atlantic. And all along the coast, you could be dealing with anywhere from 8 to 10 foot waves. Now, the maximum, this is not a forecasting certainty. It could go all the way up towards potentially 100. And the whole East Coast just sitting there with 15 to 20 foot waves all along it. I do not believe that. I know it's a possibility. I think as it slows down, this is really going to hit a couple waves, but then it's going to change direction. If you were to go by that right there, then we have 10 foot waves everywhere at this moment right now. So you go by the significant wave height. This is a census you normally go by. Chances up to 100 in some special cases. Still is going to bring big impacts. Now, when it goes towards the northeast, it's filling in that pocket a little more and more, everybody. And if this does shift a little bit more towards the west again, it could happen even more. Plus, we have that next piece that's still coming, and it's up to 30% chance for something to form right over here by the Lesser Antilles. Showing as we go Friday into Saturday, is growing with a chance for 75, almost 80% chance of being just a tropical depression, and showing it did forecast true, more likely we'll go into Atlantic, just like the Euro is saying, not what the GFS was saying. GFS is still showing something crazy, everybody. Showing two different scenarios. The Euro is showing it something very weak as you go 7 days, you go to GFS, and it's taking it further towards the west across the islands. And we look with the Euro, you see it confirms more likely we'll hit that shear that we've been discussing here on this channel and be something very weak and nothing to worry about. GFS keeps wanting to go on a mine of its own and keeps saying it will form up somewhere by Cuba, hit those very warm waters in the Gulf that hasn't been tapped into yet, and become a very strong hurricane in the Gulf right afterwards. Still need time to figure those out, everyone, but I would believe the Euro more than a GFS at this point. GFS has been consistently trying to take that into the Gulf, but since it does, we cannot rule it out. Now, our pattern are we going into right after that? You can see the pattern and we're in now. Then right afterwards is going to be some close calls, last minute formations along the coast. But right after that, this is where it's going to start coming off in favorable environment as we go through September off Africa. And if you look here, you'll see as we go middle to late September, it's going to be more favorable on the southern side of Africa. Now, for those that don't know, this is your main development region. And when they come off south off Africa, they have a way better tendency to go further towards the west. And the latest update is still showing that we have that sinking air coming in right after this wave. That's why it's having issues in the first place. But we still have those favorable environment pockets coming through. First one is around the 5th and 6th of September. Right behind it, another 10th and 11th of September. Remember, these come off Africa every 3 days. And once we go towards middle to late September, when it's coming off southern off of Africa, a lot of favorable environment coming through. That's when we have a Kelvin wave coming through. It's going to be a very robust time for hurricanes to form. Mark these words, everybody. So thank you so much for your time. I hope you have a great afternoon, everybody. I just want to give you a quick update what was going on with Hurricane Erin, because it's very concerning. Please get ready for some kind of flooding and strong winds along the coast of North Carolina if you haven't already. Please, if you have family members or friends over there along that coast, let them see this video. Let them know what is coming their way. They need to get ready for potential impacts, everybody. This is not a joke. Before I go, a quick word from our Father, everyone. 1 Timothy 2, 1 through 4. I exhort, therefore, that first of all, supplications, prayers, intercessions, and giving of thanks be made for all men, for kings and for all that are in authority, that we may lead a quiet and peaceable life in all godliness and honesty. For this is good and acceptable in the sight of God, our Savior, who will have all men to be saved and to come unto the knowledge of the truth. Amen. Have a great evening, everyone. I'll see you first thing in the morning. If I see some dramatic changes overnight, I will make you a late video later this evening. So make sure you click that bell and select all so you do get notified. Remember, above all things, all glory does go to God, our Father in heaven, Yahweh. And I always hope he keeps you safe every single day of your life and forever. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. Have a great night, everyone. I'll see you in the morning, maybe later tonight.